Okay.
There was a couple more items under correspondence that need to be addressed. In your information, I made each one of you a copy of the application for the Emergency Management Performance Grant. Ryan dropped this off yesterday, and it just needs your approval and signature.
Okay.
But you do have a copy, each of you, to look at.
This is what, pages 1 and 2? Do you have the whole grant?
That's all
grant?
He gave me. No, this is all Ryan brought in.
Can you get the rest of the application from him?
Probably.
Okay.
Is there a time limit on when this needs to be done?
Well, he didn't say. He just said, could you have the board sign this? Well, it says application date submitted is June the 30th, so there, it may be time sensitive.
Yeah, I'd like to read the entire application. Kansas Heart and Stroke.
Yes, I was
right. Ryan or Reed is gonna discuss that.
Okay. All right.
The other thing in your packet was from the Kansas Association of Counties. If anybody is going, they need a certification of voting delegates. If the Kansas Association of County Conference is November 16th. 15th, 16th, and 17th in Overland Park, and to comply with KAC bylaws that require the form to be eligible to cast your vote, they request this form be filled out. And I didn't know if anybody was going to that meeting, but it has to be filled out if you wish to vote at the conference.
I can't.
Brent, you can give up deer season and go. Isn't that right in the middle or the beginning of deer season?
Well, I've been bow hunting. Anyway, I looked at that. I think I got an email on that. I that's just too much time for me. I'd love to go back to Kansas City, though. But, you want to go? Rodney, do you want to go?
I don't see really what advantage it would be to the county on this.
Okay.
We're going to get all of the information prior to them
the only thing
assembling,
is
and they're going to vote it in. So.
Well, you have a say in the decisions that are made at KAC.
If we go.
If right.
Yeah, because we're a paid member.
Right.
I'll think about it. Okay. That's a long ways to go. Okay.
That bidding if he couldn't find anybody to cover tomorrow.
Pardon?
We're going to have to address the bidding again if we can't find somebody to cover for tomorrow. What are your thoughts on that, guys? The bidding for the MTs?
The MT guy.
When Reed comes in, because we have to have two.
Yeah.
I just think we're opening ourselves up. Ryan, they're trying to get a hold of you on this. The other parts of this performance grant, Rodney had some questions on that. Can you tell him what
else? Yeah, what are the questions? That is just the application to apply.
Okay.
You just have to sign to apply.
So after you apply, you get the package. Is that how it works?
Yes.
Okay.
Because after you apply, then you get an approval letter.
Yeah.
And then you start submitting, like, your quarterly reports and your work finances and all that stuff.
That's
just to apply.
Yeah, the additional information that, when it comes, I would like to be able to review
report.
It.
Roger had it laid on my desk.
I do have the handbook now. That.
Sure. Take a look at
you
that.
Do you guys have a problem signing that page so we can get the application?
No.
Okay.
Ed. Go ahead and sign.
Okay. I'm going to sign it.
Can we have a motion to approve this?
I'll make a motion that we approve the application for the Emergency Management Performance Grant for 2016.
All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign.
Nay. We already signed it in the past. One difference.
Okay. You want to go down as a no?
No, he does not. He does not.
Okay. Well, I need to be very specific when I write up the minutes.
Yeah, I know you do.
As far as the safety inspection, we're going to do.
No. I had the original. The original. This is your copy.
Oh, yeah.
The original.
So it really wasn't signed. It really wasn't.
The original needs to be signed.
Oh, that is a fake one you signed?
Yeah.
Well, I better vote yes.
Okay. Dave, there was a grinder issue when the safety inspector went through that we'll need to correct up at the shop. Is that correct?
We had a lot of them. Okay. We're still going to get done.
There was
we
more
60
than,
days,
than that.
We're getting probably within.
I have the report from Scott Thompson on all the corrective actions that the county needs to take. And so we have 60 days to get those corrected and the paperwork filled out. And
from the date of the inspection?
From the date that I received it, which was one day this last week. So I wanted to present it to the board and make them aware.
Oh, I thought we had probably run out of time. I didn't know.
Thank you, Dave.
August.
Okay.
Yeah, August. We have until August.
Well, we had them two inspectors, though. We had the
KCAM. Yeah, this is the Kansas Department of Labor that was here.
Okay.
This is their report.
But KCAM is.
Yeah, we still need to address that one.
I'm thinking it was within 60 days
and
or
get
so.
That back.
This Regal Corporation, this is where we got some of that air conditioner parts for the compactor. And then Unibridge did an update on the scale. And then you'll see the First National Bank Trust. This is that report that we was begging for last year, you know. We made it at the end of the year, but this is that financial assurance for the 30-year closure cost. What that one is.
And that was First National Bank, you said?
Correct.
$14,509?
Correct.
Is this for last year or
year? That's this year. Remember last year, we took a long time before we get a report,
right.
And it was, I think it was the last day of the year when we actually signed it. So, well, they're back to schedule on that deal there, so.
Now, that comes out of the waste disposal account, correct?
Solid waste, yeah.
Solid waste, yeah.
Yeah.
Are we going to need to start increasing that? Are we on target as far as area goes?
That's the scale that they say, and with it all broke down with that engineering report and everything, so we should be on target.
They refigure it for us.
Every year they adjust that.
Yeah.
Okay.
According to interest rates and all that stuff. So.
All right.
So we should be correct.
think the only thing different on that second page, Mill and Seed, that we contracted that grass seed they're drilling on our bridge projects down there. That's what we're required to do. As far as work done, gravel road, T26, we call that silage road. It's east of Mills, is going up north towards the 8 Mile. Over there by the next week, Kip Weiss, and then also north of Wheeler. And then third week, also north of Wheeler, and then north of Bradwaters, and then over there by Patrick Delano's. We did that stretch through them hills there. And then we widened, the last week we widened the road here south of the River Road Bridge, north of Bartlett's.
How'd that handle the rain?
What's that?
Did it handle the rain okay? Were you guys put that on the
No,
side?
I mean, it's soft. It was, mm-hmm. wasn't the material wanted, but they was working at the sewer pond, so.
So you get the clay stuff?
Yeah.
That's what it looked like.
So, anyway, we're trying to get some of that ready because they're going to be paving this. They said they did move that to July 25th, so that's what they're looking at now. And we did pay, we need to get that widened out. And then there was an accident, and we had to repair some guardrail on the old bonded bridge. So,
did you get a chance yet to look at that bridge out by Les Lacy's on Road 5?
Yeah.
You see why I was concerned.
It wasn't the bridge deck. It was north of it, and it just water run down the edge and swirled, made that out. But it wasn't the bridge deck.
I think it was the ridge deck. Did it fill back in with dirt again?
Well, we filled it back in with dirt, but it come down the edge, and it was right near the wing wall and the edge of the head wall of the bridge.
Okay, all right,
Yeah, we got that all correct.
Okay.
Not yet. We rented that breaker. We had to go to Caterpillar so it matched up with our machine. Paid a little more for it, but we got. I think Doug said we'll have most of it done today, and then the crusher's sitting out there, and we're going to start crushing
well,
next week.
Well, I followed it out the other day. The reason I know that's
why. Yep. So we're getting it all prepared and everything right now this week, and then we're going to crush next week.
We're not paying time while our machine's sitting right.
Right, we're only going to pay for the week that we run it. So.
Okay, just for operating hours according to the machine.
Well, it's a 40-hour work week, but yeah, it's going to be that. We're going to have to pay for the sitting time. He was in town and wanted to know if, or in Goodland, and wanted to know if we'd move it so he could get them some work done on and show us how to operate.
Well, I followed it down the highway the other day, so I know it was there. It's the reason I asked.
Okay. One question, Venture Corporation is look like they're going to have 30,000 ton of millings left.
Mm-hmm.
They want to know if we was interested in buying it. They'll take a payment this year and a payment next year. At $8 a ton.
And that would come out of your road and bridge account? This year's or next year's?
Well, partly next year. That's the reason something we need to figure and see if we're interested in.
How long would it take us to use it?
Well, it depends on what we're going to do for other projects. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason you'd mentioned, I know Long Ridge, I'd also, you know, like to see something done, you know, that going into Bird City, you know, that on the Edson Road. Two stretches I need.
You got kind of money in your fund?
Not right now, no. Not by the time we're done with that project, but if we're interested, we need to let them know.
But you'd have to come up with $120,000 this year.
We don't have it, do we? Not in the road and bridge.
Well,
because we're building that.
I don't think we would, but there again, we budgeted for higher fuel, and we've saved quite a little on that. You know, it was $100,000 extra last year just on fuel cost. So I'll do a little more figuring if you guys think you're interested, and then I'll tell them we're going to study this a little bit.
We're always interested, but we don't know that we can do it.
That's what I told him. I told him no to start with, but
we're interested in some, but not all of it, so. But he said he would make a partial payment if we was to split it.
Question. If what if the county doesn't buy the millings, what does Venture do with them?
Well, they'll probably haul them back east and sell them there.
Oh, okay.
They get a $15 ton back there where they're setting it. So.
I just wondered if there was a bargaining chip involved, because they would have to transport it.
Yeah, that's the reason he said this is cheap as they've ever sold them. So.
Anyway, he just wanted to give us an opportunity to have the first chance at it.
Okay.
So. And then this other issue, I need to see Nicole first before I discuss with you. So. That's all I got.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. Options would be that outfit that we do an appropriation to every year?
Mm-hmm. Yes. They had an emergency come up and will not be here.
Okay.
Shirley gave you that. They called this morning and said there was an emergency, so.
Did you want to discuss about Austin Peters, it looks like?
Yes. We tabled that from last month.
Mm-hmm. Larry, did you have anything?
Okay, what we tabled was the second recommendation that they made about setting a minimum
maximum salary.
Hourly rate and a maximum hourly rate.
And also there was no decision on that part of recommendation four about the fire chief.
Yeah, I think
that was...
I think that will be appropriate after the two chiefs and we get together.
Right.
We can iron that out then.
Okay.
Okay. Based on what Nicole said earlier, if we just establish the minimum and maximums and do not address the individual recalculation of the pay ranges, I think we can go ahead with the budget process and then we can look at each department and decide if we're going to do the increases. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
In other words, for budget planning, other than the 12 that we have already approved the increases on, we're putting on hold the current salary until we can look at them as an individual department. Would it be easier if we had a pay sheet in front of us to look at, to see how it would work? Because we've got to give our departments direction on the personnel line item for their departments. Either we direct them to freeze them at current rates, and we go ahead and approve the minimum and maximum hours, and then we do an adjustment based on starting next year. That's what it will be. I know some of the departments. Pardon? Yeah, this is what I gave you guys last time.
Well, yeah, but I didn't want to look for mine.
Oh. See, because if we do the adjustments right now, it'll be $12,669.61.
And that impact 17 employees?
Yes.
I just hate doing it in the middle of the budget year. It would be better. I just think it'd be better to do all this next year when we've already budgeted for it. Because
I think so too. In January, when we start.
Okay, then. Do we go ahead and approve the minimum and maximum, but not do any adjustments
until January?
Yes, Jeannie.
12 is already taken care of. You brought those 12 up to the minimum for Austin Peters, according to so that they are within the range that Austin Peters said to bring up everybody up to a minimum.
Okay, these 17 people here are already within the range. What we have previously approved was 12 people to bring them up. So that we're not. That is correct. That's done. That's yeah. So.
I applaud the idea of getting us with income comparative pay scales for the surrounding comparable counties.
Yeah.
But we've got to be really careful about how we do this and timing. I mean, mm-hmm. because we're gonna have to pick apart everybody's budget requests this year to be able to. I mean, we've already talked about we've got some ways that we can
make some cuts,
make some serious cuts mm-hmm. that will be very advantageous, but understand my apprehensiveness on anything, and it's not because I don't applaud what you're doing. Mm-hmm. It's because I want to do the best thing we can. So that's why you're sensing apprehension from me, and I think that's why you're sensing apprehension okay. from Ed as well. But I'm not saying that this doesn't need to be done, but I would vote yes, but not have it take effect until January when we can actually have everything
that's
budgeted
right on that, because we haven't budgeted for that much for this year. And the police departments are going to run short, some of them, if we don't. Where mm-hmm. is that coming from?
Based on your 6%, not all departments budgeted a 6%. And so there are some departments that are already over on their personnel.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
what I'm getting
yeah.
at.
Yeah. yeah, and we would.
So I don't think we want to raise these up until January.
Okay.
I agree. All right.
But you do.
But we will accept the range, the minimum and the maximum, so that we can plan ahead.
I agree.
Okay.
All right. Make that motion.
I'll make that a motion. I make a motion that we approve the Austin Peters range for minimum hourly rates and maximum hourly rates with no additional changes in raising of pay.
Until January?
Till January 1.
Okay.
I'll second that.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, same sign. Okay. And Ron, does that answer all your questions that you had?
Yeah.
Okay.
I do have a question, Rodney. You had asked me to renew those 12 people. When did you want to address those?
On which ones?
Those 12 people that you did approve to bring up.
Yeah, because we, when the motion was made, it was to be effective July 1st.
Right.
I think it would.
So okay. In preparation of payroll, Commissioner Radcliffe asked if I would redo these for your guys' review. So I don't know when you want to do that. These are the 12 positions that were approved at the last meeting. They're by department. That one on the emergency management responder, we didn't ever have a pay scale for that one. So I would ask your guidance on that. I took the maximum. It was to be raised $1.35, so that was the base of where I started, and then I just did an average over a five-level pay scale. I don't know if that is what you intended.
Okay. when I was looking over this again, I noticed a 2-cent error.
Oh, yeah.
I remember I came in and pointed that out to you.
Yeah.
Austin Peters said 11:37, but when you calculate it out, it's 11:35. Just a typo.
This will bring those 12 positions up to the minimum levels.
The minimum, yeah.
Well, not knowing that I couldn't rescind that, I want people to understand that we went through and we did a pay scale increase of 3% earlier this year.
We did that late fall last year.
Anyway, when I got away from the meeting last time, I was like, what happened? Anyway, and I guess the reason I was doing that and that I tried to rescind that motion was because all of this is going to have an impact on our this year's budget, mm-hmm. especially if we make it active July 1st. But finding out that I could not rescind it, I don't know if there's any way we could put this on until January, but we've already voted on it, so there isn't.
We could take some of the small surplus that's in county general and transfer it to cover these. So, and that's what's traditionally been done in this county in the past.
I see those. Did you get a chance to look at these? Sorry, they were in front of me. I didn't look at
these, but I mean, you already passed them, so.
But how is this going to affect the other additional 3% that we agreed on in the fall would be my major question.
Pardon?
How does this, because we agreed to do a 6% raise to get us within the average pay around the region. What is this going to do to the additional 3% that we're going to add next year?
We have not agreed on how much to increase next year.
Okay.
And not only that, the next year, if we use the rules this year that we'll be required to use next year, we have to go by the CPI index.
Okay. I just don't want to get in our tails.
Mm-hmm. So. On the CPI index for May 15th, it was 1%. That's all it was.
Good.
So if we go with the new rates that are in this study for next year plus 1%, that's what they're going to get. That's what we have to budget.
We're going to be within the minimum for all the areas around.
Yeah. Okay. That's assuming that it stays at 1%, but I don't see inflation in this country going up very much in the next 6 months.
Cost of living?
Yeah, the cost of living, inflation.
Okay.
Now next year, the way that rule is going to read, it'll be an average of the prior 5 years. 2014 CPI index was in the negative. So even though we're looking at an increase this year, if you average back, there isn't going to be very much cost of living. Do you want to sign those now or after the people sign them?
I think if they're approved by you first, I can go back to them and then
this was already,
we can get payroll.
That was already voted on.
Yeah, we already approved that, didn't we? Why do we need to do it twice?
They just need to be signed so that we have documentation to go in to change payroll based on your decisions.
Okay. 3% already.
I was under the understanding that 6% last year was the 3% cost of living and 3% compatibility to get the wages within. And then the board entered into an agreement with Austin Peters to do a study. And now that the study has been done, that any additional 3% doesn't necessarily pertain.
Right.
So.
And that's where I was. Where I was kind of mixed up too, because I thought it was a definite 3%, 3%. So if there's a 3% living cost of living increase this year, then we'd have a 4% raise across the board. Yeah. And so that's why I was going, whoa.
Yeah.
So.
So the other employees are within that minimum and maximum range, and so what you decide to do with for personnel in 2017, whether you freeze everything where they're at or whether you move them within that range is your decision.
And one more when we do the budget. I mean, sit down and do it. So.
Okay.
So, no questions?
No.
Reed, how are we looking for tomorrow?
Day looks pretty good.
Okay.
Night does not.
How many for the night do you have?
That's my worksheet that I was working.
This red copy? Yeah.
And I'll keep that attached with.
Okay. All right, Rodney, did you have anything else as far as that goes?
No. I want to ask the county attorney about a question Carol Spolper had, but I can do just a few minutes on that if you don't
mind. We've got 30 minutes.
Okay.
So I didn't know.
Yeah. Carol was hired in 2014 to be grant writer and assistant emergency management. Her question was, is she an exempt or non-exempt employee?
That was, remember, Austin Peters gave you recommendations.
Is that these that are the privileged ones?
And, I mean, you guys at this point need to... You're making a decision for this next year.
Yeah.
I mean, that is going to be part of when you write job descriptions, you're going to determine whether or not someone's exempt or non-exempt.
Okay.
And that's going to be based on mainly the recommendations. I mean, everything is going to remain the Austin Peters recommendations and my recommendations are everything will remain the same unless they're recommended otherwise. Does that make sense?
Okay. What we just did where you stepped out, we approved the minimum pay range and the maximum, but we're not adjusting the other 17 people because they fall inside of that range. We're
going
to do the adjustments for the next year, and we will adjust the class 1, 2, or 3, or whatever it might be. In other words, on the pay scale.
I'm not following you.
Hand me one of those so I can show her what I'm trying to say.
This copy?
No, the one where we, like Shirley's there.
The wage agreements?
Yeah.
And I there was a comment I wanted to make too. Based on Fair Labor Standards Act, those employees that the elected based on the Austin Peters is the minimum and the maximum are the same rate. So they are paid, and that's how those were figured. As if they were not an elected position, I figured those at an hourly rate. And is it okay with the board to put, because right now everybody is salaried, and that is not in compliance with Fair Labor Standards. So with these getting started with this, do I have the board's approval to change these people to hourly rates that are non-elected?
Well, I mean, there would also be non-appointed people are going to be salaried.
Well, eventually we need to get those cleaned up too, but we have to start somewhere. So, okay.
Well, and I mean, this is one of the things that we discussed in going into next year when you guys are determining personnel budget and job descriptions is there are payroll issues and legal issues with treating this casual reference to salary for what's really an hourly employee causes confusion and legal issues for both the employee and for the county.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when it comes down to it, you know, I mean, what you're really looking at is appointed and elected being salaried and exempt, and then
everybody else.
And then a few of the identified people. Or positions, I should say. It's not people specific, it's position specific, that would be salaried as well. So I think moving into next fiscal year, there needs to be a clear identification that the majority of employees in this county are hourly employees.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is going to be a small handful of employees that are going to be exempt or salaried. But I mean, that's all been, I mean, when we had the Fair Labor Standards meeting with Beth, I mean, that she pretty much covered those positions. But I mean, essentially what it is appointed, elected, and then a few higher supervisory roles within the county are going to be salaried.
Salaried.
Mm-hmm. And I, to me, the easiest way to identify that is to identify that in the job description itself for each individual employee.
Okay. Right.
Does that make sense? So as you go through each individual job description, at that point, identify, is this an hourly employee? Is this a salaried employee? And then the pay range for that position.
Yeah.
I think that's the simplest way to address that.
Okay. No, this is what I meant by the adjustments.
Okay.
Okay. What we approved was the minimum and the maximum.
Mm-hmm.
If they were already in that range, they're going to stay there until next year, and then we will adjust.
I see what you're saying. So, and you're saying for the 17, that's what you've
right.
done. Okay, so
right.
for the 17, you adopted Austin Peters' recommendation
yes.
for the minimum and maximum,
that's
but
correct.
For the employee in the position right now, it's the same as long as they fall within that same range.
Right, right. Yeah.
I follow.
Okay.
But these were the 12 positions.
Those are the
12
that we approved last meeting.
That were approved 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
They were
the
below
new wage
the range, so we brought them up.
So
okay.
My question to the board is, does the clerk's office have your approval? These positions that are non-elected and are not appointed, there's to move them to an hourly rate, because right now they're in the system as a salary rate.
Okay.
So
I see what you're saying.
With these,
that's a payroll.
I need your approval.
Isn't that going to be easier if we do this for every position by the formal adoption of a job description that identifies whether or not the person is hourly or salary, rather than kind of doing some now and kind of doing some later?
Okay. So you're suggesting that these changes here are still, like the positions in the county clerk's office, there's mm-hmm. two people that are not elected or appointed.
Mm-hmm.
So leave them at a salary rate until they formally adopt the...
My concern is if you... Part of the problem in this county has been this piecemeal, we do this here, we do that there, rather than a concerted, mm-hmm. thoughtful effort to maintain consistency. I mean, that's my only concern, is if you tell Deb, oh, change these people here, and then what if we don't follow through on the rest? What if something happens? As opposed to setting down, working through, and I really think per my prior recommendation, the easiest, most efficient, productive way to probably do this is to pull those job descriptions for each individual department and work through those with the department during budget, the budget workday, and adopt it at that point. And part of the job description will be a payroll designation about whether or not that person's salaried or hourly.
That way the employee understands and management understands.
Well, and I think also what's going to help you there is, I mean, you're going to have the department head giving you input,
mm-hmm.
Not only as to the job description, but as to the classification of that employee.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that makes the most, because then what you're going to do is each time you wrap up a department head meeting, you've taken care of the ranges, job descriptions, and payroll status for each employee within that department. And so you take off that department, you've got their feedback, you make a decision, you move on to the next department.
Okay.
And I think that's going to encourage a more consistent result and ensures that everything is taken care of in a formal way so we don't take a piecemeal approach. I mean, that's my only concern, and that's the problem I've seen coming in, is there has been too many, we'll take care of these two issues that are connected to these three issues, and then these three issues never get addressed, and then you end up with an inconsistency.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, ultimately, it is up to the board on how to address that, but I mean, my take is that's probably to ensure consistency and just for ease. I think that's probably going to be the best way to handle that.
So just leave it in the system.
As a salary rate.
Yeah.
As a salary.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. We, Reed, did you want to come do a closure first? Okay. Did anybody else have anything? Okay.
So, on this recommendation that we did you cite that it's available, this report that we talked about, who would be bumped up and who's in the second recommendation group due to years of service?
Well, at this point, you guys have approved that, so that would be public, right?
Not the salary ranges. That one was the... That one report was, but it didn't have the I think Dave's talking about the names of the individuals.
Yeah, but at this point, they have adopted those recommendations, correct?
The minimum and maximum.
The minimum and the maximum.
Okay, so that's public.
That's public.
Yes.
Okay, so the identified positions and the ranges adopted are definitely public.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
The ones that you adjusted, we get to see that report then. That's why it was moved up. That was suggested from Austin Peters.
The ones that were... You mean the 12? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, well, that was already released last week. Or, I mean, last meeting.
I agree, but can we see that report that Austin Peters presented that said who was to be raised up and what rate?
I thought it was put on the website.
I did not get a copy.
The 52-page report or whatever it is?
Okay. But the graphs don't match up to the raises that was given. That's reading those wondering.
Well, if you start, I think about page 3 in there, there is a chart, and it shows you in there.
Okay.
The chart starts on page 7, but the recommendation starts on page 3.
Okay.
Come on up here.
Was that emailed to all the department heads?
Pardon?
Yes, I had emailed that report out.
I couldn't open it if I got it.
If you didn't get it, I'll be happy to send it to you.
Deb, and I would, because I'll tell you, like, I have seen that, but I have never myself been provided that official copy, so you might want to email it back out to all the departments.
Do you have this in your packets?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
You're not going to complain today, are you?
No.
Good.
This is it. This is an agreement between the Kansas Heart and Stroke Collaborative Group and EMS. It's called a participation agreement that they came up with. What they've identified is they initially, when they started this project, they partnered with the local hospitals, and they've been doing so quite successfully, and now they want to include EMS in that. They have identified some things that they believe if we can tackle as a collaborative group out here, with EMS, that maybe there's some additional grant funding that they can apply for as a collaborative that we couldn't on our own. So that's really the purpose of this agreement. It's a lot of pages. Did you have a chance, Nicole, to go over it?
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
No, that's fine. The second page, basically the duties of EMS, I've reviewed those. And although they're pretty vague in exactly what the duties are, most of this stuff we've been working with them without a contract and providing them data and stuff like that for them to go forward anyway. So I don't see a problem with a big issue with allocating resources. We've kind of been doing it along the lines. It's just a 12-page contract now. But obviously, we'd want Nicole to bless it also. So, and I don't think we're in a big hurry for it. It does. Attachment A is a standard business associate HIPAA agreement that starts on page 7.
Deb, even though I won't be at the next meeting, can you just put this contract on old business? And yes. then I will email you and the board. I've got halfway through it, did not see any issues, but I want to read the rest, and then I'll just email you and the board if I have any legal concerns or objections. And my guess is I probably won't. It looks like a very standard agreement, but I still want to get through the last half of it. And that way, if there's no issues, then the board can just go ahead and adopt it under old business for the next meeting.
Did you guys have any concern with it?
I didn't. Okay. I read it over the other evening, and no.
I think it's just going to require a little bit of my time to pull statistics for them, which we're already doing, and with the return on investment of hopefully some additional
grant funding
to help Northwest Kansas EMS. And this collaborative is expanding. They started with just the Northwest Kansas counties out here, and they've expanded statewide. So it's kind of a neat thing.
It is very.
So that's all I have, unless you had something else.
As far as your coverage.
Those two warrants, let him know that we're going to be charging a different account.
For the POP and the other stuff, we brought out of a different account instead of the memorial fund. He looked up a resolution.
Donations?
Yeah. So
no, not donations.
It was a memorial fund, wasn't it?
It was taken out of donations, but
it should have been memorials.
No, it was taken out of memorial, but we turned it into taken out of
memorial is only okay. For equipment.
Right. Just so you know.
And when we deposit that into those accounts, we don't separate them out.
It is done when you deposit.
You guys do that on your end, okay? Oh, like on the memo line, if they put, okay, good enough.
Now that's done. Old school.
It works for me?
You know it better, yes. We just moved those.
I'll give you my copy. I'll make another copy, but there's a copy of the resolution, so you know what you're.
Okay.
What you're required to do.
Okay.
just assumed somebody stepped up and took it.
I know, me too.
Oh, for coverage?
Yeah. We've got to have coverage. What's your thoughts on that, Rodney? We kind of hit on that a little bit earlier. Like on a holiday weekend, I mean, that we, within reason.
Because probably what's going to happen is, yes, you have the issue on this holiday weekend.
Put it up for bid and see what you get.
But once Tyler leaves on the 15th, I think we're going to have a lot, you know, just midweek holes.
The earliest we could get a class in is next fall, correct, for an EMS class?
This fall.
This fall. When, I'm just looking at, I want to look at your budget. I want to see where we're at. I want to get a class going. That way we can help fill these voids. But I want to also make sure that we have somebody covering the shifts. Mm-hmm. And we want to help you, but we've got to do it within a budget. So
if you can answer this, if you can answer where those matching funds are for our grant in the tune of, I think, about $47,000 for the current budget year, we can not expense those funds.
Because you don't know where they're at?
Because we don't have the second person hired. We could wait until January 1st of next year to put out and hire that position if that helps you with your budgeting.
Okay. Well, I just want to make sure the shifts are covered. You know where I'm coming from on that. So, what do you guys, what's your thoughts?
I don't know where the closest training is other than Colby used to do it.
Goodland does it quite frequently, too.
Quite frequently?
Yeah. They'll have at least one, if not two, classes a year.
In reading old minutes, I noticed that we've been paying, the county's been paying after the person completes the training.
To teach a class, you mean?
No.
Oh.
To pay their cost of the EMS course, I believe, is what, for 2 years, correct?
Yeah.
They help us for 2 years.
They go, they pay for it, they bring a receipt back to us, and we reimburse them.
It actually doesn't cost them anything. That's directly paid from the county.
It is directly paid.
And it is a two-year agreement, though.
And then it's a two-year agreement.
So, yeah, you're on the right track.
And the
it's kind of hard to read those old minutes if you're not as complete as the ones we do now. So.
And historically, we've always qualified for the EIG grant, which means the state covers that class. Mm-hmm. And the kicker next year is they're putting some requirements to get those grant funds that we have to do. We have to report statistics back to the state. So it looks like they're kind of forcing us into the electronic area a little more, which is how they do things.
How everything's going, isn't it?
But, if that money's available, I think that might really help you get coverage covered for the rest of the year, and then you can budget for next year. But
any thoughts?
That's
not
really a legal issue. That's a
Now, if that money's not there, I mean, then we've got.
Is there a way to maybe set a maximum on the bidding? I mean, or. What do you think?
I don't know. Do you have a suggestion there?
Well, what would your suggestion be if we tried to...
Well, here's what we did in March, and we know it worked, is we just offered them $15 an hour. That was the minimum, that was the maximum, that's what it was. That was basically the same rate that I was paying my full-time techs in Atwood. That's why we came up with that number. So it really wasn't a bidding process. It was a temporary rate increase for those shifts that we couldn't get filled by volunteer sign up.
We might be shooting ourselves in the foot, though, too.
You can, and that's the thing.
Because then people won't want to volunteer anymore. They want
to
be...
To be honest, what I found out with shift bidding is it took time for them to bid their shifts, and some of them weren't even willing to do that.
Is it a 12-hour shift, 8-hour shift?
12.
Now, this is for coverage for Bird City, correct?
And St. Francis.
$80.
Yeah.
A shift.
Well, I'll be real honest. You're probably not going to get people to sign up for Bird City because they're not there.
Four people per day. Yeah, that's pretty damn costly.
It is costly, and I guess... But, I mean, these are the unfilled shifts. These aren't the filled shifts. And historically, they haven't abused the system.
Well, I think what Brett's getting at, though, is once you start this, then is it going to cost us for everybody?
You know, in a way, this goes back to what I stated in our budget meeting. As a county, we're trying to run two ambulance services. Mm-hmm. Financially, we're strapped. In reality, we ought to be running one, take the Bird City resources, consolidate those, and run one. I mean, that's a harsh decision, but that is the economic decision.
Well, yeah, but Bird City shows up. Why don't we take Sadie's and move it to Bird City?
And that's, you know, I mean, that decision, yeah. it's going to take a while to have those conversations.
That's the way I figure. I mean, the response time, you're about going to have two of them. Because what you say, you had 5 minutes or something to respond.
Well,
that's
in the county.
In the county.
In the county.
Not the city.
So, and that is to leave the ambulance station.
Yeah.
So, let's say there's a Bird City call today, and there's nobody over in Bird City. St. Francis then gets paged because nobody responded in Bird City. St. Francis will meet that requirement. They left their station headquarters within 5 minutes. Now, it took them an extra, you know, probably 20 minutes to get to the patient, depending on where the patient's at. And that's where you're going to have your issue with the taxpayers, your tax base.
But that's as far as the
state,
issue.
Right, the state is fine with that.
Mm-hmm.
You've met your requirement of the 5-minute response. And maybe I come back every month and we review how much we spent on shift bidding. And I mean, just because it's approved for this payroll doesn't mean it has to be approved for next payroll. Because we've been doing it for about a year and it hasn't cost us a whole lot of money except March, and we knew March. So
how much lead time do you need to put a special question on the general election ballot?
I think that was June the 1st that we had to have it on the primary ballot. So if it's November, I would say sometime in September.
Okay, we could do a resolution to put it to vote. And if the county wants to pay that, that's fine.
Put what to vote? Whether or not to have a station in Bird City?
That's correct. That is correct. That is, I mean, that's the hard question, but the hard answer is, where's the dollars going to come from? If the county